survive in this teaching society or teaching world because of that particular quality that I have with me, that is getting socialized so easily. And especially in an engineering university, I'm a humanity teacher. So students look forward with a humanitarian expression only. Ma'am, we are looking forward for a humanity from you like that. So I'm ought to be a humanitarian person in an engineering university towards engineering students, because we don't have a degree program of sociology here. We teach engineering students humanity courses. For them, our courses are university electives and few are core actually. So they have to complete 3 to 4 courses in sociology and psychology. So we teach both the courses to them. And that is a platform we get to get into those engineering students. And our class is a platform they look forward for a really break free like that. Continuous engineering sessions, either it's whatever maybe the discipline they belong to. Because VIT goes with a fully flexible credit system. So we don't have a particular class group like that and all. So the students who register under us would be from any degree, any branch like that. So every time heterogeneous classes, they don't come as a classroom or batchmates like that. For them, every 6 months, the class batchmate will change. Because next 6 months they go for some other course, they opted, some other batchmates will be there. So we don't have a kind of a 4 years, the same group of people as classmates. That concept we don't have. It is fully flexible credit system. So they choose. We will give all the courses required to them. They choose the course which semester they wanted to do, under which teacher. Because we just show them who are all teachers who are teaching this particular course in this particular semester. It is their own freedom to choose which teacher they want also, which slot they want. Everything, it's their own freedom. And ultimately, with respect to all these freedom, what students look forward by having this flexibility is the reason why they wanted that flexibility that they look in the classroom also. Because they come towards us, especially humanity subject, they come towards us. And present day students, you all know, for them, everything they try to connect with society and they learn the reality. Not like way back we had this particular course means they'll only study this. Even present day, your animation or whatever course you're doing, you can understand students are trying to connect with the present day society and try to connect with the reality and the application. What I'm going to do with this course, how this course is going to help me out. So this is what they look forward from us. And really, we are also having an equal challenge in teaching this present Z or X or whatever millennials we refer them. But on the other side, we are learning a lot by teaching them. What we learn from our curriculum is something different. What we learn from them in teaching them, that is a real challenge and that is real learning, I would really say, and which we can feel it every day. We are getting really getting learned every day. We are getting groomed because by teaching them, we learn a lot from them ultimately.
I have one information to share. Actually, one of my niece is actually studying in VIT Chennai. And, you know, when I met her recently, I was just asking her, like, you know, can you share your, you know, what all the subjects that you're learning? And she gave me a list of around 15 courses that, you know, she's taking up. And I told, you know, where is the semester system? Like, you know, they should be, you know, that this, you know, subject wise and all should be there. And she told, no, it's not like that. I am selecting the courses and whichever the courses that I am selecting, I'll be taking it and the credits will add up to that particular part. It was a very interesting conversation that I had with her, you know, and the way the, you know, the VIT is actually, you know, handling the courses. It's a good initiative, ma'am. So that's what I just wanted to communicate.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Yeah, that's what I was also referring to. Yes, Bhavna, we need to go there.
Yeah, sure. Sorry for that.
Very good topic only. But you want to make a formal start. Okay.
Okay. Very good afternoon to one and all here. Today, the second day of our research and the professional development. Yesterday, we had a very wonderful session, ma'am. Thanks a lot. We learned a lot. We learned a lot of, like, you know, new knowledge about the research. And then, you know, hopefully, today's session also is more interactive for our, like, you know, entire team. Welcome back to the second day, ma'am. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Bhavna. Thank you. you, thank you. Yes, a whole day today I have planned it with a way that we will have an activity mode. As I told yesterday itself, I hope you are all ready with your paper and pen and a small homework that I gave you yesterday. Let me just share my screen. Yeah, day two. Is my screen in a slideshow?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Okay. And yes, so day two. Okay. We're all for in expectation with the day two like that. Okay. Yes. Now I'm in the same place where I stopped yesterday. Okay. No, don't expect the coffee picture because that will come at the end. If I show now, everybody will get a feel of that you wanted a tea or a coffee. It's such an addictive feeling. Even I'm addicted to it actually. But let us start with the same place where we stopped yesterday. Okay. This is what, yesterday I started with a story. Today I wanted to start it with a quote. That is a message for the day, I can say. Can somebody read it?
Tell me and I forget. Teach me and I remember. Involve me and I learn. Benjamin Franklin.
Yes. So what today we are going to do, yesterday I taught you something, hope you remember it, and today we're going to involve in it so that we learn through it. Okay. So this is what we are trying to go make it today. I hope that we would do, because research is not a particular topic to be discussed within 2 days. It's a big ocean. But possibly whatever we can cover in these 2 stipulated days. And always I'm with you. You are with me. And whenever you want to come back and ask some clarifications, you can. Even I will also give my own suggestions. If at all you want to add on something, yes, you can add to it. If I'm not able to answer you, I'll just verify, ask few people whom I know who have taken to me, okay, who have explained me things, and then I'll get back to you. So always we can be in touch. That I wanted to say. And the whole thing cannot be covered in these 2 days. Whatever possible we can cover, we will get an idea about what we can do as far as research is concerned. A beginning framework we will get in these 2 days. Monday is over, today is second day, but always we'll be in touch to discuss in person about the topic or the issues or the difficulties that you're going to face if at all you go with any research as such. Okay, this is in a front note I would like to see. Yeah, this is the activity which we stopped yesterday. Let's research. And I hope you all have a paper. Okay. You have already written your topic of research. So when you're going to go for a formulating a topic of research or identifying your problem. So in that sense, you're going to enter. What are the aspects that you have to keep in mind? Because right now you have it in your hand. So I just wanted you to cross-verify whether your problem is able to match with the expectations. Okay, number one, a good research problem is compelling. Compelling in the sense that it requires a study now. Like that, there should be a push, a pressure, a requirement, or something that is already done over long time before. You need not take it now and there is no value at all now, right now about it, means there is no need of do that research. Since because you are interested, since because you have all the data with your material, with your people with you. No, that would be not be, for example, like way back, I would remember my undergraduate research topic. Actually, when I was doing my BS sociology, we need to do a small project on some topic. It was at that time, it was about diabetes, I did, connecting to health sociology. What are the people's awareness about diabetes? Okay, the same way I did a PG project, awareness about HIV in the fisherman community in Pondicherry. You know, the same topic, if I'm going to look into, totally I have to rework my paper, because awareness about diabetes is nothing now. Everybody know about diabetes. At that time, when I asked people, I'm talking about way back in 2002, in that phase. Right now, how people look for COVID-19, at that time, they were looking for diabetes like that. Too much of stigma was there. People are not able to say that they have diabetes. If a mother-in-law is having diabetes, if a daughter-in-law is going to tell that, it's going to create a big problem in the family. How that you can tell to others that I'm a diabetic? Okay, if they go to a common gathering or a social function, they actually wanted to have the same coffee with the normal sugar. They don't say others that less sugar. If somebody says less sugar, there is a big stigma on that posed on them that, are you a diabetic? Like that. But now it has become a status quo. I'm a diabetic. Like that. Okay. People start with, see, I'm a diabetic. Make sure that you don't add sugar. Like that, it has become a status quo. And similarly, when I was doing my PG, some program, a small project, mini project in Pondicherry, at that time, we were having about the awareness of fishermen community, boys about HIV. When I went there, it was around in the year, some 2005 and all I can say. When I went there and I was asking to young boys around 25 in the age, even I was a little younger than them, but I considered them as young boys who will have some awareness, you know, mosquito bite, you know, the way back our HIV questions and all, will that spread HIV? They were answering yes and all at that time. And some 40, 45 age old people came and they said that, why are you asking all these rubbish to our young children? You know, I was so young than them, but the guy, the around 40, 45 who referred me, telling that, why do you want to talk all these rubbish and spoil them? They didn't look it as awareness. They looked it as something that they should not know. Stigma. But now it is of nothing because I can generally ask about HIV. People are able to answer. So why I'm referring this? Some point of time, everything changes. We need to be updated about the changes. One, and a research, good research problem is something compelling. Need of the day, requirement of the day, like that. That is more important. You look your sheet, your topic is that need of a day, a requirement, or you don't need to study at all. Something that is an old concept like that. Then you need to rework on, rephrase or change your idea. A good research problem must support multiple perspectives. You will be able to look in. Yesterday itself, I told, especially media, I was referring yesterday, like us, for you also, your problem cannot have one perspective. It will have a sociological perspective, psychological perspective, media, in the sense like economic perspective, a political perspective, a public perspective, like that. It will have a cultural perspective. So the topic that what you are going to choose should have multiple perspectives. It should not go with only one perspective means then you will not able to build your research problem in a better way. So once if you're going to take a problem, because half stated problem itself is half solved, you would have heard about it. You're going to make a proper statement of the problem. If you're going to make a proper statement of the problem, that is a half solved problem. That's what the proverb says actually. So one, it should have multiple perspective. So check whether your problem that you have chosen has multiple perspective possibilities are there. Very important third point, that is it should be researchable. Okay, something that you are not able to make research out of it at all. Say for right now you are here, okay, but on present day there are many possibilities to make any topics researchable, but still there are topics which you can't actually go into and find out like that. Say for the present scenario, yeah, Britain yesterday and all, we are able to find a news that in UK there is a situation, there is a shift or a change in the virus. The virus has gone to a different way or a different mode, and now we are not able. So right now sitting here, you want to study about it. Is it researchable? You don't know the patients. You don't know what is happening. You can just get the opinions. Maybe you have people in London. You can get the opinions. But still, what has been undergone by the concerned patient? It's very difficult. So take something that is researchable. Okay, you're able to make a research. And in this, I will add that it should be feasible also. Both are different. Researchable is different and feasibility is different. Feasibility is talking about only the possibility. Sitting here doing there, that is a feasible issue. But researchable is whether there is a possibility to make a undergo a research on it. That itself should be a big question if at all you're going to take a topic which is not researchable. So check whether. And four, umbrella topics must be sufficiently complex. That is, don't take a very broad area. Umbrella topic in the sense that covers everything under one roof. Like that means you don't know where you can land. Ultimately, you can't generalize anything. Because in research, we would try to come out with some inferences and we will try to generalize to at least a group of population. But if you're going to take a very broad area, then it's very difficult to come draw for an inference and try to generalize with respect to one particular population. So better we need not actually step into a very broad area. We need to narrow down and be very specific. That's what I'm trying to tell in this. And research problem identification and overcoming the hurdles or difficulties. See, all these what I referred comes under this. That is, when you're going to take up a research problem, you will be coming across a lot of the difficulties or hurdles, whether this is feasible, whether you can go ahead like that. So let us try to understand this with respect to a small example. Okay, I would like to hear any one problem just written by any one participant.
Ma'am, I wrote one problem yesterday. Reach an affordability factor of the digital learning applications across all strata of society for secondary and higher secondary education.
Okay, so reach and affordability, you're talking about accessibility and affordability. Am I right?
Yes, accessibility and affordability, yes.
Okay, so I'm just rephrasing your reach just to make it in a sense of understanding. So accessibility and affordability, can you continue?
Of digital learning applications.
Of digital learning applications, okay.
Across all strata of society.
Across all strata of society.
For secondary and higher secondary education.
Okay, across all strata of society for secondary and higher secondary. You've given all and then you've brought in a specification. How come? Okay, then within secondary and higher secondary, you want to bring in all strata.
Huh.
Okay.
Okay.
Am I right? That is what
you're trying to write.
You have given it in a different connotation so that the meaning may misunderstand. In this, okay. What I'm trying to say, a hurdle or difficulty is this framing the, okay, just when you frame this research problem, I state the problem itself, whether what I am trying to say, whether it has been communicated.
Correct.
Okay. That itself is the first challenge. And one more. There is always a question by people who are pursuing PhD. I don't know how many of you here in this forum are pursuing PhD, and of course, you will be having an aspiration to pursue PhD or in the process or would have completed. There are many doctors I'm able to see also. Okay, one or two doctors are there. Yes. So on the other side, what happens is we will start from one way. Okay, our vehicle would start from one direction, from one place, and you have a plan to go to, you have a road and you want to travel in that road. But all possibility, you may go in different routes to reach a destination. When you reach a destination, you may find that you have reached some other destination. Okay, that is also possible. Why? What I'm trying to say here is research problem stating, make it little, not very much perfect. Okay. Just you try to make it in such a way, these you wanted to, okay. Little it can be flexible, and in the end when you're going to, there is all possibility you can rephrase the title, okay. Till the end of your submission of your PhD or till the end of your submission of your research papers, there is all possibility that you can rephrase your title. You start with secondary and tertiary learners, but later on in the data collection, you're able to take only secondary learners. Then you can confine and change your topic to secondary also. You start with all the strata. I hope here you are referring strata as all the category of people,
sections of people,
sections,
yes,
of society,
yes.
I think so. You need not refer in your title at all.
Okay,
you can bring in your methodology that you are bringing in all the strata, and your inference would tell, or your analysis would tell, that what is the distribution of strata in your data. Okay. So you're not going to plan, if you're going to plan it, then it is a challenge in your methodology to have equal distribution from all the strata there.
Okay.
So something that you're going to put it in your problem, then you need to be very specific about it. So you are going to narrow down only, but among the narrow down area, make it little broader or flexible space when you state a problem.
Okay,
that is what I'm referring here as a hurdle or a difficulty. Sometimes when we are into the process of data collection, and whenever after getting the data in the analysis, you will be able, what you have in your hand only, you can actually project it. Okay, you cannot project it, or you can at least add as a limitation in the end that I will be explaining you, which you planned for, but you landed somewhere because of the limitation that you couldn't cover the other area like that. But make it little flexible, because in the end there is all possibility that you have to rephrase it. So don't go for too specific. In this particular area, in this particular school, like that, you're going to end up into too specific. If you're not going to get the data, then you have to rework from the beginning. So in the beginning, of course, you have to narrow down. In the area, when you narrow down, little be flexible and little be general.
Okay.
So you can't go for an umbrella. That is very big, broader area. Say for, you cannot say that all apps on all students, then it is very general. Okay. So you're going to be very specific with respect to digital learning technique, with respect to some specific population, that is secondary level learners or tertiary level learners. So that be specific, and in that give some flexibility. This is what properly you gave me an example so that I'm able to explain you that what is the hurdle. And as I referred, twice or thrice or one number of times, try to read and check your statement whether it sounds with the same meaning to others also. Okay, you will have some idea in your mind as right now what you said also. See, we had a different understanding because what to keep first, what to keep next, that we need to understand. So you try to, that is the reason always in a PhD phase or in a phase when you prepare a paper and all, we always advise people to go for some PowerPoint, that is presentation in a conference. Why conference presentation, in what way help us? Because when we are going to present in front of others itself, see, Rinnie, when you are written, it is a different. When you are explaining me itself, you would have understood there is some lag in the formation.
Sure.
There is some way that is something, the meaning is not actually delivered in a way which I expect to, because you are the researcher. Yeah. I can't change your expectation. I can't change your research problem. But whether the research problem is stated in a way as how you want to state it. Understood in a way as how you want to state it. Okay. So this communication of a research problem, statement of the problem is where you communicate your research problem. So that to be stated in a right way. Okay. So can I have another example?
Yeah, ma'am. Yes. I'm Gokula Krishnan.
Hello, sir.
Very good afternoon, ma'am. And yesterday and even now also the class is very, I mean, session is very interesting.
Thank you, sir.
The past 7 months, I'm there in my native place near Ooty.
Okay.
So 5 months back, I got this, subject to research, and I discussed with Bhavana ma'am about this. And somehow I prepared a document and I shared a questionnaire with all the families and all. So my topic actually in village and all, we won't get enough networks and even in papers also, I see some incident like students are because of network, because of they don't have a mobile. So few students are suicide, and some students are somewhere in the hilltop to get network to attend these online classes and all. So based on this, I have selected one topic. It's online education and its effective practice.
Okay.
So this is what my topic title. So here I prepared already one questionnaire with the around 20 to 25 questions, and I already shared with the families. So if you want, I can share the screen, but seriously, like I just somehow I formed my document, but I don't know further what to do. And okay. So Bhavana ma'am told me like once we come to Bangalore, then we can discuss, go through very clearly with this, but still I'm in my native, so that's the reason I'm unable to take forward with this research paper.
No problem, sir, no problem. Wherever you are, we can do the research. Now, the present day, as you said, please tell your title, sir.
Online education and its effective practice, because the thing is, those students are from village area, or those who are there in the low network area, and even very poor people, they don't have mobile to access. If some families, if they have two students, then they have maybe only one mobile. So they are unable to, attend that online classes. So this is the main reason to prepare this paper.
Absolutely right, sir. And this particular concept in present day, okay, we are referring with the, as I referred, after the problem, we'll go to conceptual definition, right? So this particular practice, as you said, that people are not able to access the education. The online education is effective for population who are able to access and afford. But the one who is not able to access and afford, they are not what we are going to term them. Right now, we have got a new concept, emerged concept, that is digital divide.
Okay.
Because recently we had a conference on digital learning and digital divide organized by myself and my team. Okay, in VIT. So the new concept that we have, it has emerged for this particular scenario which you are explaining, that is digital divide. Because education, we felt that we, to some extent, we have reached equality in education. Okay, we were all really, we were all feeling very proud. Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, there are a lot of education schemes and programs on present day. There is no caste discrimination, does this. So equality in education in India has reached to a good level. That is what we all felt. But this particular COVID-19 lockdown situation, where we are into digital teaching learning process, have made us to understand that there is still the divide. Okay, the difference still exists. That is what is digital divide. That is the one who is not able to access and afford to this particular online education. A wonderful poster was one drawn by one of my students, or even I saw that poster in different places also in Google. That is, one particular child is sitting and looking at the laptop and let us listening to the class. Another child is standing near the window of this house, outside the window of this house, through the window, seeing the laptop of the other child.
Yes.
Way back, you remember our television and all? When we were not able to access or afford television, people used to go to the next house for television. People used to stand outside and look from the window for the television like that. Okay, so that was a divide. But on present day, we feel that we are better in that. India has really developed. Before COVID-19, we all had such feeling. Okay, education, there is an equality in education like that. But present day, we were able to see that lack. Still, there is a divide. There is a very big group of population who is not able to access education in this scenario. Though Kalvi channel or whatever channel is there, but still on the other side, we are not able to make that equality in education among all the children. That is, children who are opting for a private school and children who are studying in a government school. Are you able to see the equality? No. Now it is not there. And think about this 1 year education for those children.
Correct.
At least for a private school children, that is a continuum. Through the online education, we need to say, we need to be happy about at least this online education. Why? On one advantage of it, it really gave us a good boon. It is a boon that which really helped us for a continuing in continuation in the education, or else people would have lost that particular touch with any knowledge or education as such. But on the other side, we are able to see the divide also. Okay, yeah. Vulnerable, marginalized, here also there is a marginalization with respect to the people who are not able to access and afford. So it's a wonderful topic, but you also, I could see the topic to be very general. Okay. Whom you are asking it?
Correct.
Okay, you're going to ask both the population equally and find out the difference among them, or you're asking the population who are only able to afford it, and through means. If you're going to send it through WhatsApp, then obviously it is a population who is able to access that WhatsApp.
Correct.
Then we are already excluding a population who is not able to access that kind of a technology. But the ultimate expectation of that particular research is to bring out those who are not able to access.
Correct, correct. See, actually, the thing is, like, one is for online questionnaire I prepared through, I mean, already forwarded through mail and WhatsApp, and also another one, like a normal with the paper, that direct, because I have contacted few families in nearby the village area, and I collected the direct reply from them in paper. So whatever the tick mark or no, or so like that also I collected. But the thing is now I have all the data now, but next I don't know how to conclude this, and what kind of measures I have to, to do complete this paper. So
very simple we can do, sir. Today in the end you will have an idea, and anytime I can also help you to convert it as a paper. Okay,
sure.
You said it is around 25 questions, and you have samples around can I know the number?
No, actually through mail I got around 106 replies.
Okay,
so I'm
in person
around 18 to 20.
Not a problem, because then you cannot specify with respect to which population. Let it be a general paper, just getting the opinions of people about the effectiveness of online teaching.
Okay.
With the data that you've collected, I can just frame it in this way only, because ultimately it is a perception and attitude of people you can put. But if you're not involved any specific perception attitude question, then opinion of people about the effectiveness in on. So opinion about effectiveness on online teaching. Okay. Like that, online teaching learning process, because it's not online teaching, it's online learning. Okay. Online teaching, you have to ask the teachers.
Okay.
And it is going to be online learning only then. So in this way, you can make it very general, and we can convert it as a paper, and you will have an opinion study that tells about effectiveness of online learning process. Okay, irrespective of the population. We can't specify the population because you have randomly sent to people.
Correct.
And so the negative or a drawback or a difficulty here is your finding can't be generalized also.
Correct.
Okay, your finding cannot be generalized to across the population because it's a random population that is chosen. But in general, you can just specify this is the opinion of people. Okay, like that we can give a kind of a discussion, not actually a conclusion as such.
Fine.
That is possible that there we can convert it as a paper. But okay, and this would be applicable only in this particular phase.
Okay, I understand.
That is also there. So if you're going to do a work in this particular phase, better to publish in this phase itself, because after this phase, this may not have a importance. The significance of it will go down. So these are all the hurdle, difficulty in formulating a problem. Why I'm specifying this compelling, multiple perspective, researchable. These are all aspects that is connecting, because either whether it has a demand across the year, across a period of time, or it is demanding at particular point of time.
Okay.
So if it is particular point of time, then you need to bring out the inference also at that time itself. You can't just, there are some topics you can always do a research and keep it aside, because it is evergreen topics like that. And all the time you can do a lot of family studies or elderly studies and all evergreen topics.
Fine, yes.
Especially in India, a lot of social problem evergreen, poverty, child labor, evergreen, because we are never out of corruption, evergreen. Okay, but if you're going to take a stipulated problem with respect to a stipulated time, okay, so time is very important when you choose a research problem. Is it applicable in this point of time, or it is always? If it is now, then the inference has to be drawn immediately and published as early, so that it would help the policymakers in some way or other, because any research problem should have a social relevance.
Correct.
Please reason that, for understand that, for what purpose we are doing. It should not be for your purpose to get some publication. Okay, that is different. Okay.
No.
I'm just giving general.
I agree that actual situation is, even whatever that village side students are facing that network issue, same thing I'm facing past 7 months. So.
Difficulty.
Exactly.
We are talking about difficulty. Yes, that should be a paper on this difficulty itself. Like that. And that difficulty, as I said, only for this particular time.
Correct.
When this is over, everything is resumes back, we talk about the difficulty, what we had in lockdown situation. Next lockdown only it will happen, now you leave it. Like that only people will think. So it should be published in this point of time in order to help the policymakers to make some changes with respect to the requirement. Because as I said, any topic that is researchable should have a social relevance.
Correct.
That should actually add some information or some kind of an inference or finding or anything to the real world. Some solution to the real world. So that is more important. Try to do that. Maybe our students, when they start with their projects in their first year, second year, third year, we need to tell them from then onwards itself to develop this attitude to make any research for some social cause, for some social outcome. It should not be for their personal outcome. Okay, obviously you will have a personal outcome out of that. That is different when you go. But on the other side, the outcome will be really good if you're going to work on some work that really gives a social outcome. Okay, yes. So I hope right now you all would have rephrased your problem that you have in your hand. I'll give you another 1 minute. Just read it once for yourself. Okay, always the second reading is always good. So once again, you read it. Okay, better I would change it like this, like that. If you want any rephrasing, rephrase. If you want to tell me now, yes, you can tell me and ask me whether it is fine or to be rephrased. I have another 1 minute for all before we go to the step two. Yeah. Yes.
Ma'am, I actually had two things in mind. One is actually a technical paper and the other is, which works on the research part of it. The technical paper is about, there is this concept that is called as a Mandelbulb. It's actually a fractal, graphics, which is used. So what it converts is, it converts the 2D fractal noise into a three-dimensional world. So that is called as Mandelbulb. Now, until now, it's not been incorporated in the 3D applications like Maya, 3ds Max or Blender as such. So I just wanted one technical paper where I could develop a plugin or something like that, where I can incorporate that into 3D application. So that is one of the technical paper I was just thinking about.
Yeah, you can put in brackets that you're going to make an exploratory in it.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, that's great. Yes.
Yeah. The second part is the animation styles and its popularities. That is the title of that. As it. An animation part of it, we don't have only two types of styles. One is 3D and 2D. We have other types of animations also, experimental animation, cutout, thread, water, you name it, any type of animation styles we can do. So just want to look at the popularity index of this styles of animation.
Okay.
So I want to make research about it where I could take feedback from the people regarding watching a clip and which makes them very attractive, like whether 3D, 2D or any other styles of animation.
So you will make them to watch a clip and then get the response.
Yes, ma'am. A small clip.
Then it becomes experimental.
Experimental. Okay.
Because when you said in the beginning to find out the popularity index, that was, I thought it was different because all would have seen things already. So if at all, like we can ask them whether you have seen 3D or 2D, like that, asking them the opinion about the popularity index or asking their perception about the popularity index or finding out the popularity index with their own response with respect to 3D or 2D, that is different.
Yes.
Okay, then it becomes only descriptive. But when you're going to show a clip and then make it, it becomes an experimental. And it is in experimental, a limitation is, or you can say that a difference also, not necessarily limitation, that only a limited audience can participate. Limited respondents can participate.
Okay.
If it is descriptive, find out a popularity index, you can go in for a very detailed study. You can ask many people about it just to pass the questionnaire through email or anything, and those all who have already watched all these things, they will give their opinions. With that, you can find out the popularity index.
Okay.
And then based on that, you can go for a experimental also further.
Okay.
If at all you don't have a kind of a proper literature review about the popularity index, then you can go for a baseline survey and then jump into taking a specific population. Mm-hmm. Okay. That you need to decide who is the specific population you're going to take for your experimental. That is those who belong to these animation group. That is maybe your animation students. For popularity index, you don't require animation students. Anybody can give. Whoever has watched, they can give. But on the other side, when you want to experiment it, then the one should know the nuances of it. Okay. If you're going to show me 3D and 2D and layman, I'm talking about, they may not know much difference.
Okay.
Or peripherally, they may say something, not technically about it. But an animation student will have a deeper knowledge in it and will have a proper response. So if you're going to go for an experiment, then as you referred, since you said you want to show a clip and say, then you need to take a target audience. It becomes an experimental. Then it is only possible for a limited respondents because you can't make an experimental with an extensive number of respondents.
Okay.
So You can think about it, whether you want only the popularity index or you want to show them and identify the popularity index, whether it is going to have any impact on it.
Yes, ma'am. Yes,
okay. So whether this finding out a popular index, really you want to make an experiment? That's a question. They would have already seen. If so, really want to make an experiment means then it is different. But sometimes we need not. It is just we want to find out the popularity index. But on the other side, you want to see the effect of one particular 3D, 2D like that. Then you can go for experiment. Okay. Yes. So this is what I feel with respect to the problem that you have stated.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. That is absolutely correct. It is for the animation students only. Because their students are also fixated towards only two types of animation.
Okay.
They're not, looking at elsewhere, trying to find out these styles of animation. And that is the need of the hour in the industry also.
Okay.
So just to find out what is their thinking capacity related to imagining animation in different mediums, they just wanted to find out.
In addition, you will have an advantage of bringing them an awareness about the other mediums also.
Yes. Yes.
So experiment actually have that kind of a one additional aspect because you give an intervention. So the population get awareness because of the intervention. And your pre and post will make you to understand the differences between that also. That is whether it has a really, the styles have an impact. As you said, there are many other styles. So whether the other styles have what kind of impact that you can know in your post test.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, okay. what about the plugin which I was telling you about, the technical part of it? It is actually an invention kind of a scenario. Right?
No. Yes. The exploratory studies, you don't require any hypothesis at all. Okay, because exploratory study, you're going to go for a new invention or a new innovation, or you're going to explore it, find out. So you don't require a baseline hypothesis. I'll be just telling it in the next slide, forthcoming slide about it. So you get, and as I said in the last class itself, you have a flexibility. Okay, yes. You just start your travel and where you end, you have to come back and you are writing.
Okay, okay.
Okay, so as far as exploratory study is concerned, you cannot actually have a blueprint or a framework and start your travel. It's an open ground. You're going to travel like that. You start your travel. And on the travel only, you go and formulate your requirement or tools, necessary tools like that. And when you finish your travel, whatever you're going to get in your hand, that is going to, you are going to come back and rephrase your title accordingly.
Sure.
Okay, so you can go ahead, sir. Exploratory study is possible. There is no requirement on a hypothesis. But if you just find out, is there any similar studies? Some literature review is required.
Yes.
Even it is exploratory, it may be a very new technique going to try or draw like research about. There will be some similar techniques which is already there. That you need to make a review of literature so that you will have some, because on a blind area, you can't actually walk. So yes. We need to have a kind of a focus on one particular point means literature review only will help us to get that focus. And for exploratory study also literature review is required. Some similar techniques will be there. So you knowing that you can travel on this and you can find out the difference between others and this and how this is exclusive, how this is unique. And that would be your finding in the end.
Okay.
Okay. Yes.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you. So this is what, so right now all of you would have rephrased your research problem or the way you have stated is right or not, you would have rechecked. Okay, so that is first. So as I said, a properly stated problem is half solved. So first work we have done. Okay, as I said, you need to start with literature review and then after stating the problem, now you know what is your area. On that particular area, you have to go for a review of literature. So maximum try to find out all the published sources with respect to that particular topic, which will help you a lot with respect to your secondary data. Review of literature directly helps us for a secondary data. Okay, because if you're going to write any research paper or if you're going to write your thesis, in an introduction part, you will be giving some base information about the topic. What are the different trend analysis or statistics with respect to that particular area, which has been published in the different sources like that. So, and it is the one that is going to give you the research gap also. As I already said, the same area would be discussed by n number of people, but all the people would have left something in the with respect to that when you go for a review of literature. But how to review a literature? This is also a question in our mind. It's very easy to say that review 100 articles. You know, I still know there are guides who actually count articles, not about looking at what has been reviewed, but just looking at the number of papers reviewed. 100, 150, it is not about numbers at all. It's about how we review. There are some small techniques. I will tell you how to review a paper. Though you all know to review different papers, you already reviewed. Some tips you can just take it from me, which will really help you to write your review of literature. It can be for a research paper or for a thesis. Okay. Only the content extensiveness differs from thesis and the paper. Okay. Otherwise, both have the same work only. You take a research article, okay? First thing what we can do is just take any article, whichever the problem that you have stated in that particular area, choose one article, okay? Take the article. First, what you have to note down. Please, as far as when you do a review of literature, in an orderly way, if you wanted to do, have an Excel sheet along with you, okay? I know you all are well versed in technology. That is the reason I'm trying to help you with the technology itself. Please have an Excel sheet. And in the Excel sheet, you can just put some columns like serial number, as usual, one, and name of the paper. Okay, that is the title of the paper. And then name of the journal. Okay, and then before the name of the journal, I'm sorry, name of the paper followed by the author's name. Okay, followed by author's name, followed by year. Third column, I'm talking about year of publication.
Reference for pattern.
Yes, sir.
How we used to refer.
Yes, you can take citation. APA style itself, American Psychological Association or MLA. But please do that in your Excel sheet when you review papers. Just have a Excel sheet and put such columns. Okay, it's very simple work, but really will help us. Okay.
When I started sorry to interrupt, ma'am.
Yes, sir.
Here,
yes, sir.
I would like to share my experience.
Please.
Why? Because whenever I start writing, I start collecting the data, I used to start following the, in the beginning itself, framing the reference style.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever the style was, you know.
Expected.
So, yeah, expected. Then that would be very easy for us. Once we highlighted the point what we require, we can simply copy from there and we can mention the reference column itself.
Yeah.
Otherwise, and at the end of the present paper, we need to again search for where this reference point is. Otherwise, that would not valid. We need to look for the citation again.
Yes. And one more drawback is sometimes what we do is we just search and find out and we make the review and write. Later on when we search, they would have blocked the paper. Sometimes something is open, another point, the other point, the author will block it. So we may not know. Sometimes we are able to download, sometimes we are not able to download. But on the other side, as Janathan
sir also If we are not able to follow this structural pattern, even in the review literature also, at the end of the writing of a paper, that becomes very difficult to quote the in-text citation, quote the reference style at the end itself. That's why from the beginning itself, we must follow the systematic documentation also, that references, everything.
Yes. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Thank you. And why I said you to make this Excel format, because different journals have different format. Some may ask for MLA format, some may ask for APA format. So references format differs from journal to journal on present day. So this Excel will also help us in addition with filtration. So suddenly, if you want to know year-wise, okay, if you want to filter recent papers of after 2K, like that, if you want to filter, it will help us. Filtering the authors. Okay. So for many reasons, Excel will really help us. And Excel is a good backup also. Okay. So when you're going to make a review of literature, suddenly you're going to type, find an article on that particular, immediately have an Excel in your desktop itself. So immediately open that. Just first type this name of the title of the paper, author, year, journal, even the pages, everything. You just put everything in an order and just save and keep it. And every time when you open an article, do it. First thing you do is this. I'm going to tell about how to review. But first thing, before you read the paper, first what you read is the title and the name of the author and the journal. So all these things, first you go and register. Okay, record and keep it. Okay, and then you're going to read the article. Okay, all of us know every article will have an abstract. Abstract, first of all, we should know how to write an abstract. Abstract is not about introducing a topic. There are a lot of misconceptions in abstract. Before a study itself, writing a proposal is different. Abstract is different. Many times tend to send very fast proposal as abstract to many conferences. And they also are so generous to accept it. That is different. But abstract is actually just a gist of the whole study. An abstract will start with an introduction, will have even a review, will have all the methods and tools, will have a finding with a conclusion line in the last with respect to the topic that you have selected. Really, it may be very few words which a particular journal is expecting. But that particular few words should cover all this, only that is abstract. If you're going to read an abstract, you will know the whole article talks about what. The particular article started with this idea and they have made study on this and they have made analysis on this population with the help of these tools and applied these tests and got these findings and concluded as, once again, back to the topic. First line, the loop, pool loop should be covered. Okay, loop should close. First line started with the topic, explaining the topic needs. So the end would be, yes, online education, effectiveness of online learning techniques help the people who are able to access and afford it. Like that, and not able to reach the people who are not able to access and afford to it. Like that, where you start, there you end, but in between whole process is there, but it may be very less number of words, but it should cover the whole study. So that is only really abstract. The moment when you read an abstract of an article, we can understand the quality of the paper. Or the quality of the paper in the sense that how the researcher has written the paper. It talks about the quality of the researcher ultimately. So that is abstract. So have a glance of abstract, because why I'm asking you to have a glance of abstract or the review of literature is, you know where to go and find what. Okay. The moment you see the glance of the abstract, you know that what is the topic about? What are the different tools applied, methods used, tools applied? What is the finding? These four are answered already in abstract. If not answered, there are abstracts which doesn't answer this. You have to go in find of it. Okay, so you are going for it. Make sure that you don't, I know that it's very difficult for all of us to read whole articles. Full article reading means we don't actually sincerely do it. If at all you're going to work for some 50 to 60 papers, means it's not possible for us to go for a reading of all. So, but we'll just have a peripheral reading about introduction, some statistics they would have given. Of course, just have a look on it, because sometimes for your study, it will be like last census, means in 2021 now, it's going to be 2011, some census would have taken. So that is the last recorded data. Even now, till now, after that, we don't have. So for that, some secondary data which has been useful, from which source they have taken, kindly have a note of it. Don't take that and paste it in your paper. It is theirs. So you have to go to the source and take it from there rather than taking from the paper. If at all they would have some modified something, they would have not got caught. But if you take it, you will get caught. So no need to take the secondary data, but here look into the secondary data and find out from which source they have taken it. If it is really required or helpful to you because the source has not changed, there is no change in the pattern of the growth at all, then you can note down the source so that you can go and you can easily take it. One. Then comes to the next level, review of literature. What are the articles they have reviewed, they would have shown it. Just you have a glance. Maybe you also will have the same articles sometimes you know will also use. Just have a look. We need not go into it. And please don't paste the review of literature of others, because as the same, the review of literature is only their opinion, what they have written, not the article that they have reviewed. Because review of literature is all about somebody has published a paper and you are writing your opinion about that publication.
Researcher interpretation.
Yeah, of course. There is a subjectivity comes in. A research paper is all about objectivity. So you lose the objectivity of your paper if you're going to take somebody's review and put on yours, where you lack that objectivity, because yes, the review you take, it's not so-and-so, so-and-so's opinion on so-and-so. So there enters the subjectivity, becomes spuriousness with respect to biased, it will become. So you leave, no need to have more importance to that part. Then we move on for the methods and analysis. That is very much required. So you have the title with respect to what they have started. So have their problem identified. So take their statement of the problem and from the introductory pages, lines that they have written, and directly come to methodology to find out, to reach that problem, what are the methods they used. Just note down the methods. Okay, I'm simply telling how to write a review now. Okay, so you're writing their statement of the problem, and then you're going to write their objectives. We will know the next slide is about objectives, because when you just break the problems, you will get the objectives. Okay, and what are their objectives? Only for the objectives, you're going to make your tool, you're going to test your hypothesis. Everything is for the objectives. Whether they are able to reach that, through what method they reached it. Try to note down that alone, and where they landed in the end. That is their finding. Very simple. So four things. Okay. Now you can write on your own. So and so has analyzed in their paper entitled. Okay. This particular title referred, you can refer the name of that. And as usual, our review started so and so bracket year. Okay, analyzed in their paper entitled name of the paper, and then wherein what they try to applying these methods. And especially the sample size, if at all in a particular population at all. So in this particular area with this particular population, they have analyzed and they have found what. And in addition, what is your contribution in review of literature? Find out the strength and weakness of the paper. This is all that person has done. You're only summarizing it. Okay, it is a comprehension what work you are doing. Okay, a big paragraph summarized into a small paragraph. A big paper summarized into a small paragraph, like an abstract. Okay, so it is not only review of literature, is not only summarizing it. Where the role of the researcher comes in, where it is, you're going to rank the strength and weakness of the paper. So this paper has tried to answer these things, but has not answered these things. A small review of literature can give a gap for another researcher. Okay, so your review of, that is the reason where people are very much fond of review papers. You go and see very big Scopus Index journals and all, more review papers get selected, because you're trying to criticizing, you're trying to bring in the strength and weakness of others. Very famous published articles are there, but you read and tell that this is there, this they have found, but this has been lapsed, or this, there is some problem in identifying this. So this was not answered at all till the end. The start would be with that, but not answered until the end. There is another researcher where there's a scope for another researcher to make a study on that particular, or even that researcher itself, when they, where the citation comes in. How a paper gets cited, the reason, because when you're going to project some strength and weakness, somebody reads it, will feel that, okay, I've got a scope here. Even the same scholar reads that, oh, somebody has criticized me. Okay, so this is how therein we are going to really enter the zone of review of literature. You will really find more interesting when you start doing this. And if you're going to have some 40 papers, 50 papers doing this practice as a review of literature, your knowledge in that particular topic will really go high, because you're going to find strength and weakness, and you will make sure that you will not give any such scope for weakness. Okay, that is the human mentality, right? So all those gaps you will try to answer in your research then. Okay, 10 papers, if you're going to read, 10 papers will give some gaps to you. 10 papers will say that what the researcher started and where he landed. 100% all researchers will be having some lagging in their research, or some limitation they themselves would have quoted, that you take as your advantage. And that you try to answer if possible. And obviously that becomes your uniqueness. Because in descriptive study, always there's a question, where is the uniqueness? Everybody does the same topic. You're also doing the same topic. Where is the uniqueness? Where we can prove our uniqueness is, yes, finding the lagging in other topic. And I would be the person to try to balance that. giving an answer for that, then that comes a real uniqueness in any descriptive research. Exploratory research is different, but not all the research is possible to be an exploratory research. No, most of us are doing descriptive research only, because in a world of this, every topic is already researched. It's very difficult to find a topic that is untouched. So most of us do descriptive research only. So here we can make our uniqueness in this way, and try doing this review of literature. Reviews will not become boring aspect. Reviews are no, will not become a copy paste aspect, wherein you have a lot of scope to identify, because it is always interesting to identify something negative in somebody's, right? And that is a step. That is the advantage for research. Someone is there, you know, our very old poet Nakira, like that, there is a phrases and all also. Nakiran is a person who always, a very famous poet, you always find fault with others. Even the Lord Shiva came and made the phrase poem, and in Lord Shiva's poem also Nakira find a fault. Okay, and say that this is a fault. So we should be Nakiras in making review of literature. That is what I'm trying to say. Okay, I don't know how many know this story. More Tamilians will know the story. Very famous movie has that story. But ultimately, that the talent I'm talking about, that is the reason Nakiran magazine, which always questions everything. You know, very famous magazine, media people will know that. You know, Nakiran magazine itself is known for questioning only. Okay, just question. That is the quality we require for review of literature. We have to develop. All of us have inside us. Okay, we do that only to the person whom we don't like. Okay, but do it for all the review articles. That is what is required. Okay, yes, with this review of literature zone, do your review. Be very interesting. It's a very interesting part. We give very less importance to this part. But it is the one that should be given more importance, because 10 paper you review, you will be easy to write one paper out of it. And in your phase of review of literature, you try for one review paper. There is nothing wrong. Before going for a research paper, it's always good for a review paper. And all first papers, it's good to be a research, review paper. I always say my research scholars to go for one review paper first and then try for any research paper. Because through review paper, you will know many people, how they have made their studies. And then it will be easy for you to make your own study. Okay, so better you all of you have to try review papers, and review papers are more welcoming in very good journals nowadays. Okay, coming to the next objectives of the research. Okay, I know that little I have to make it fast to cover all the aspects. As I said, 2 days are not enough, but still we will try to. Okay, objectives. All research right now you have in your hand. Okay, you have a topic in your hand, you're going to make an objective. Okay, because review, we didn't do it, because I explained you how to do, you will do. That is what I'm trying to say, that now this we have to do as an activity. So objectives of the research are designed to understand the direction through which research topic will be studied. Objectives will help in shaping the research design and acts as a guide to analyze the inferences, and also helps in report writing. So everything is objective only then. So only your objective, there are 4 objectives, I can make 40 questions, I will say. Directly, every objective 10 question, 40 question, socioeconomic or demographic, some another 10 question, basic question, age, marital status, how many children, all general question, first 10, then objective 10, 10, 10, 10, 50 question. You give me any 4 objective, immediately I'll give 50 question to you, the moment I look at it. So objectives are the key that takes a travel for the whole, it's a map, Dora's map, how to go. So that is there in your objective like that. So what to be there in objective? So if you have, as I said, today you all have a research problem in your hand. There are some keywords I've written. So what all to be there in the first objective always should be on a very general, okay? Many of our studies, even media studies, sociology, psychology studies and all, we are working with a population. Okay, I'm not talking about the technical paper which sir is referring. I'm talking about the second paper which sir was referring me. So all the studies that relates with the population possibly have your first objective that talks about the demographic profile. Demographic profile will include age, sex, marital status, income, occupation, income, and then housing conditions, if at all required for the study. Okay, wherein the other aspects are not required for the study. There are a lot of demographic. Okay, you just go and see any national health survey or any national sample survey, NSS and all. They have a list of variables for demographic variables like that. Demography is nothing but about the population, quality of the population or the nature of the population. Okay, you want to know about the people, just as sir was telling me, online education, online learning. I'm asking everybody without asking any demographic data. If I'm going to ask, if I'm going to say I'm able to take the education, immediately where I will check their occupation, their income. With that, I will find out their affordability. Somebody is not able to, I will check what is their own living condition, status. Okay, so economy makes a plays a major role. So long
region.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am. Region also.
Pardon, sir?
Region.
That's what all the demographic variables according to your topic, that makes a very important connection with respect to your topic. Geographical, as Janardhan sir was explaining about the region, so the geographical locality wherein the person is there, that really makes a big difference or a significance with respect to the topic that we are going to deal with, or with respect to even sometimes your religion or your culture. There are topics that also requires all these things. So it depends on the topic. As I said, so you have the demographic variable, whichever is actually connected to your topic, educational status, economic status, all these things makes a very big important role as far as objectives are concerned. Any topic, technical topics may not require, but for that some base technical requirements, that should be your first objective. What I'm trying to say is your first objective about the population you're going to make study, it should be about the population, the demographic variables. About a technology you're going to make study, it is something based of that particular technology, when the technology came, some background history about that origin and development of that technology. So that should be the first objective. So have that in general first objective. Then only you're coming to the second and third objective or fourth objective. I have given some keywords, that is nature, extent, and effect. Okay, try to answer these three. The role and possible influence. Try to answer these two. And how and to what extent influencing factors, okay, change this particular aspect like that. So these are all some keywords, because it differs from topic to topic, the framing the sentence, but you have your title, look into the title and try to jot down some points about what you're going to study from this. What you want, what result you want in this, what outcome you're expecting, like that. So if you're going to break it into 3-4 points, that becomes your objective. Dini ma'am, are you ready with your objectives?
Yes, ma'am, but I don't think they are exactly the way that you have explained right now. So I think I'll have to do changes. But I had some, like, since it was related to digital learning applications. So the first I have written down, ma'am, I'm just reading those in sentence forms I've written. Digital learning application comes with the comfort of accessing education at any place, any time, no matter which place of the globe you may be. The ease of accessibility factor of digital learning applications have led to its increased popularity. That was my first one. My second one was with the aid of visually appealing animated infographics, the content of
Just a minute. Okay. Because with your explanation itself, I would like to explain so that we will not miss the timing. That's why. Okay. So she explained the first aspect that she wanted to know from the population, or which she wanted to know, that's all. But on the other side, it's a statement which she has explained. An objective cannot be a statement. Okay, and an objective is something that you wanted to find out. So if you wanted to find out something, then it should start with
how, why.
No, an objective is not a question on the other side. An objective is an inquisitiveness to find out something with respect to the problem that you have stated. So better to have objectives in this way. Yes, somebody wants to say before I want to say something? Okay. So better to state your objectives, because you're going to state your objectives. So you're not writing a statement, okay? So it should not be a full paragraph statement. It is not a question. On the other side, it is to identify something, to analyze something, to evolve something, to find out something, to elucidate something, okay? You can put in any way. Better you put your objective as a way that it should start with TO. You try to put two and reframe your objectives, easily you will get your objectives.
Bloom taxonomy higher order.
Yes. I was just wondering when ma'am was saying that.
And that is the order of our research also, man.
Okay.
How the order of Bloom's taxonomy goes, that because it's an increasing order. You understand, then you analyze, then you, create is the higher level, that is different. Maybe our final objective will also, there is a possibility on present day having a final objective to create. Some create is what? You are creating an app. Getting all the data from people, what is required for them, you're going to create for them, then it becomes create. But very few studies we have that final objective of create, because in all studies it's not possible. But suggest policy like that instead of create. What on other studies you are trying to make? Suggest. But there are possibility in your studies, create is possible. Okay, because what is the user's requirement you're going to get, and you're going to come out with an app or a net or a particular website, then it becomes the create. Okay, all have all the Bloom's taxonomy in front of you. It's very easy to frame the objective. Bhavna has given a good suggestion. Okay, and I want all of you to frame your objective now. I'll give you 2 minutes. 2 minutes, look at your research problem. Okay, break it down. Through that particular problem, what all you can do, you try to write. Okay, that is what. See, she said that digital learning app to tertiary students or secondary students belonging to all the strata. Like that means my first objective would be from the population. Okay, knowing the socioeconomic conditions of the students belonging to secondary and tertiary. That would be my first, because I should know from what background they are coming, whether they are able to use this app. Without knowing that, I can't just tell that this is not effective at all like that. Okay, so I should know that. Number two, their accessibility with respect to digital tools. Okay, is socioeconomic condition I may ask first, and then I would like to know their affordability and accessibility. That is what she was actually reading as a paragraph. Number two, and then can you continue the third one, which you are trying to read? I gave a break to you.
The other one was... with the aid of, this is again sentence, we'll have
it's
to change.
Okay, it's okay. You read the sentence.
With the aid of visually appealing animated infographics, the content of these digital classrooms have immensely supported in enhanced retention of its learning.
Okay, so she has already given a conclusion, but we are going to find out that. So the effect of, okay, like that you are going to convert. So to identify or to find out the effect of, okay, what you're trying, the visual aid, okay, whether it is going to support the learners, okay, the impact or effect, anything you can use. So there is a difference in both the things. So when you're going to use accordingly, then you have to use. So what is the effect on, because of the effect, what is the impact? You can make it as two objectives also. Because of the effect, what is the impact? Like that. So whether really you say it is enhancing, but your finding only should come in that way. Okay, so that is what I'm trying to say, that please have a question in your mind. Don't conclude. Okay.
Ma'am, yes. I shared mine in the chat box, ma'am.
Yeah, I'll just look it. So thank you. Yes. There is an abstract, am I right, sir?
Yes, ma'am.
Online education is not quite famous in developing countries. There are very less online institutions because of worldwide COVID-19 pandemic. Now all over, all online is education and learning is boom. There are few major differences between traditional teaching and digital teaching. Only few major differences, sir. Vast major differences, I would say. Urban and rural area are totally two opposite edges to follow online education. Economy and emotion are going to play major role in these teaching methods. Based on finding, the author going to analyze how poor and middle class economy students are struggling to convert to this online mode currently. Yes, sir. This I would say not a complete abstract actually, because it is only your proposal to do this.
Okay.
You have proposed your idea. But as I said, abstract will incorporate the methods that you apply, because abstract can be written only after the study. Please understand.
Okay.
When you complete the study, only you can write the abstract. Before that, what you write is only a proposal.
Fine.
Okay. And when you complete, so to understand this, these methods are applied using survey research, survey method. The questionnaire was framed and the data was collected with respect to these population, and it was found that.
Okay.
You're going to give your conclusion, it becomes a perfect abstract then. Okay, sir. And yes, as you have given your title here, that is to analyze how poor and middle class economy students are struggling to convert to this online mode currently, then you're clearly given your population as that particular downtrodden people only.
Okay, cool.
Okay, then it becomes focus only to them. Okay, though you have written in the introduction as urban and rural are totally opposite edges to follow online, but here you are, what you have written, based on the finding, the author going to analyze how poor and middle class economy students. So your target population itself is those students.
No, see, I'm going to conduct research in maybe all over the population, but my main motto is going to give the proper analysis only with the poor and middle class.
Then why you want to conduct all over?
No. See, sometimes we need to compare, right? Okay, these people are getting these facilities, but these people are not getting it, so that...
Then your topic will change. This is what I'm telling. So we need to actually think about the topic that is researchable, feasibility I'm talking about, because wherein you're going to miss an important essence in this and you're going to get some other essence from them, that would really create a kind of a misunderstanding in our own study also. Yes, you can, but your title itself will make them comparing on the other side. Then asking them about what kind of impact they have with respect to their learning system, that's a different zone. Telling that those who are accessing, those who have the online facility of online learning, how much online learning is effective compared to traditional learning. That's a different comparison then.
Okay.
But here we are going to try to find out those who are not accessible to them. Okay. So how much they are struggling to get into that particular mode of education. Your problem states that.
Yes.
Am I right, sir? So
yes.
Your problem down, it states that how much they are struggling to. So better, see, normally what we think, we will take online education. And the first objective will talk about general population. Second objective, those who are having the facility. Third objective, those who are not having the facility. No. So better, those two are different ends. As you said, those two are opposite edges. So you can't, don't connect it in one paper, because the paper would be very general then. Better go for very much specific about that particular population itself and try to find out the problems they face and prospects that they require, so that your conclusion will help for policymakers, or at least when you publish for the readers, what can be done. Okay, what can be done to bridge the gap? Because here we are talking about bridging the gap. And what the other group facility that they have, in no way it is going to bridge the gap.
Okay.
You're able to understand, sir.
Correct.
So in that way, more in the paper would be amicable when you're going to make it more specific. That is the reason I'm trying to say.
Sure,
but
sir.
It's a great idea and your introduction sounds really good. Really good. And in the same way, this can be broken into the different parts, like the nature, extent and effect, and the possible and the role and the possible influences that can be drawn. Then you can make a specific 3 to 4 objectives.
Sure.
Okay. Sure, sir. Because you are going to make a small paper with respect to the population, 3 to 4 objectives are enough. So there is no condition that
can be write in the points, or it must be in a paragraph kind of thing.
abstract that is according to the requirement of the journal. The journals have their own templates. Okay. We are expected to follow the templates. But in general, when we write the abstract, it is a kind of a paragraph of some stipulated words whichever journal has or any expected authority has, and it can be a paragraph but including all these points.
Fine.
Okay, it should be point wise in a paragraph.
Okay.
Okay, kind of an introduction on the methods used and tools used and your finding, like that. It's point wise but in a paragraph form.
Sure.
Okay. Abstract 300 to max 500. Yes, in general 300 to max 500. But present day, a lot of issues with the way we have, because every journal has a specific template. Paragraph, not in point. Yes.
Can I add one point, ma'am?
Please, sir.
Recently, I have submitted an abstract to the global virtual conference conducting by the MICA, ma'am.
Okay.
They proposed that a 500 words limit.
Okay.
I sent the abstract 300 to 350. They suggest me you must meet the criteria of 500 words exactly.
Yes.
That's what these days, the conferences, journals, they're all very particular about the words.
Words.
Yes, ma'am. Their template.
I still remember, sir, this problem. Yes, I am referring is because how much it is restricting our thought, actually. It is really a hurdle. Yes, or a kind of a limitation, I would say that, when we were actually working on some aspect of the research, the limiting, when you start limiting the words, sometimes it changes our thought itself. What we wanted to say, yes, it is totally changed. Not only, as you
sometimes
said,
we need more words. Sometimes
that is also, it changed the direction of what we wanted to say, ultimately.
Yes,
but on the other side, yes, the ultimate expectation for us is to publish the source and present it in particular forum. So we need, yes, to fit into the expectation, yes, what they have.
Yes,
and whenever we prepare a paper itself, better we have some backup material which we can actually add in, or we can actually drop down.
Yes,
so that we always have to have in mind, because as I said, the expectation differs from journal to journal, and nowadays it's like they have their own
styles,
and they have, yes, their own page where we have to fill into that. We are not going to upload,
yes,
anything,
ma'am.
We have to fill into that next,
yes,
letter. You can't even type, it stops there.
Yes, ma'am.
The word itself,
yes,
is not complete, but there is a block because the stipulated number of words is there in the box that they have given. So beyond that, you can't type.
Yes,
then
ma'am.
You have to delete some words here and there. And, sometimes I have deleted some spaces and all. After full stop, we need to have some space. That space also matters because it is not connected as a word. They have calculated as spaces. So 500 means sometimes I deleted some spaces in order to finish a sentence or finish a particular word, like that. And yes, that limitation we have. But on the other side, when we start writing our paper, don't have that limitation, because those limitations really stucks your thought process.
Yes, ma'am.
Write,
yes,
it.
Ma'am.
Later stress. On fitting it, then we can modify things, delete some words, rephrase,
yeah,
something.
Once we become familiar in writing the research styles, then we can restrict it, or else we can extend that also.
Yes. So better don't take the format and start making the paper. There are many people present day, they are doing that, because later on it's a second work of changing it as a paper to that particular format like that. Don't do that. The paper itself has general format which we are explaining now. Have all the papers in a general format and then convert to the expected format of that particular journal. But don't write papers with respect to the format of the journal, because sometimes that journal you will get disqualified, or they don't agree. Then you have to send it for some other journal. Then once again, you have to sit and change the format. But if you have a base format which can fit in any format, then it is obviously good. Okay. So this is objective. I want you people to write. Yes, Rini, you have written something now?
Yes, yes, ma'am. I just wrote, I just rephrased those into three right now.
Yes.
The first one, as you had suggested, I wrote to analyze the socioeconomic condition of the secondary and tertiary students. That is the first one.
If you're going to write to analyze for socioeconomic condition, then you are expected to analyze. Okay. See, Bloom's taxonomy, we said, we always start with understand, identify, only then you can analyze. When you start with analyze, nothing wrong, but your study has some importance with that, then you have to analyze that. Okay, see, my study was, as I said, self-help group, women empowerment. I wanted to analyze their socioeconomic condition because that was a key aspect for empowerment. But to you, you're going to know about their app, that is digital learning app, in the way.
I want to know the affordability, whether they can afford it or not. So that is why their socioeconomic condition becomes important for me to analyze.
Of course, you should know that. Then you should analyze that. You should have those variables as independent variable. That is what I'm trying to say. If you're going to write your objective as analyze and you're going to present, somebody would ask you, have you really analyzed your socioeconomic conditions? So if you're going to take some independent variable from that, obviously you have it, their education you wanted, their economy you wanted. So you can say that, yes, I have taken independent variable from that. Then you can use. This is generally I'm telling because from your answer only, I'm trying to give the answers for all. That's why. Yes. What is your second?
To elucidate accessibility factor of digital learning applications.
Okay, to elucidate the accessibility factors of digital learning application. So only the accessibility factor. Okay, and this accessibility factor will also be there in your socioeconomic condition actually. Will you agree that? Because there itself you're going to ask their region. But you wanted to give much more importance to this accessibility. So yes, what I am referring is that your topic, if at all your topic talks about accessibility, okay, as a limitation or the effect of online digital app is not actually been there because there is a difference because of the accessibility, then you can draw it as a separate objective. If not, the first objective itself will give some answers for this. But then you have to go in deeper to frame specific questions for accessibility.
Yes, okay.
Accessibility is not about only the region-wise geographical accessibility. When it comes to app and all, it is digital accessibility. Okay, so wherein you have the other aspects also, even economy comes in there, affordability comes in there. Okay, why can't you add both the things, accessibility and affordability?
In one.
You're going to have separately for affordability?
Because the topic that I was, which I referred to was accessibility and affordability factor.
Okay, so your third is about affordability?
Yes, my third is to examine the cost effectiveness of the digital learning applications.
Okay, fine. What is your fourth?
I haven't yet framed the fourth
one. You didn't tell about the effect at all, man. You told that this virtual aid, how much it is going to create an effect on it, whether it is going to support the learners or not. That was your explanation in the beginning.
That I haven't framed yet with the action verbs. But initially what I had is that what I'd written is that globalized learning approach has been possible with the digital medium, where concepts are examined by the best of the best teachers in the best possible way.
So to understand or to, we have to like, because the impact of this global approach that is learning. What we wanted to find out. So to what extent this global, if you're going to refer that, what do you mean by global approach? There comes a big question. Because I wanted to land in this question only to take you to the next level. Okay, so we will go to the next level. That is, we are going to take a question from Nini. That is, what is mean by global approach? I'm just putting a pause here, hypothesis. Before that, where is that? I just missed it. It's okay. Define and redefine. I have written here. That is what. So in your objectives, you're going to use this word to know the extent of impact of this global approach with respect to teaching, how much people are able to get this or what is the impact of it. But what is global approach? Everybody will not know. So what you have to do is, as I read on here, you have to define what is global approach and you have to redefine what is in your study as global approach.
Okay.
Okay. So that is what I have written there. Try. time to reinvent yourself. That is try. Now you can, all of you can try from your own study, take one particular word and write. Okay, say for our sir, Vocal sir was telling about online learning or online education. So what he refers to as online education, that is in general, that is the definition that is there encyclopedia or Wikipedia that is given. But what you refer in your study as online education, where he explains about that particular online education, whether it is going for the backward and the middle class people. Okay, that specification he can explain as online education is the education that which has been given in this particular mode through a kind of an online mode to this particular population. Like that you can refer. And similarly, in US, global approach, teaching approach, global teaching approach is something there conceptual already, but operational definition, what you are referring to in your study. Okay, wherein children are able to meet the teachers through whatever the mode that we are having, that is a Zoom. Because in general, there are many, but what you're going to conduct in your population, there are few. So specify that. So through Zoom, when they are able to see the teacher and see all the visual aids, when they learn through that, how much it is they are able to learn a concept. That I'm trying to understand or trying to explain as in the phrase of global approach. So very important here is conceptualization and operational definition. So have a conceptual understanding and then try to redefine, because it is not going to be the same for your research. You're going to little locally, you are going to say something about it. Okay, because everything on present hand, it is available globally, and ultimately in your research, you're going to make something that is locally, and that is what we wanted to know as far as our operational definition is concerned. What you going to, what is your definition or what you're going to try to say in this particular aspect? Okay, please. Then coming to the next phrase, hypothesis. Okay, objectives are framed. Okay, that has given you a proper way. Okay, yes, good. But along with the hypothesis, there is something also I want to add on, that is research questions. You have to start with research questions, and research questions will lead to hypothesis. Okay, all your objectives, to find the answer to your objective, you should have some questions. Okay, very simple. To find answers to your objectives, you need to have some questions. Okay. A research topic can be broken into some 4 or 5 objectives, means it can be taken into some 2 or 3 questions. Okay. And that 2 or 3 questions you try to write as a question itself. Sometimes some research papers, we don't show research questions, but a lot of psychological research, they don't have hypothesis. They have research question. Even exploratory research, our sir was telling, Arun sir was explaining me, right? He can have some research questions, sir. You cannot have a hypothesis because it is exploratory, but some query is there in your mind. This new technology will help in this way. This new technique will be in this possibility. So that is a research question. So technical papers also, since it's a new technical paper, then not hypothesis means, then you can have a research question. Okay. And a hypothesis is nothing but the same research question converted as a tentative statement. Okay, and predictive statement and assumptive statement. Okay, will this have relationship on this? Will this be in this way? Like that, we have a kind of a question in our mind when we go through in our research that has been framed as a tentative statement, that is nothing but hypothesis. Why we have hypothesis? Is that sure that you should have hypothesis? Without hypothesis, a paper cannot be scientific at all. Can I have some answers? Because these are all the questions that is running in our mind. Am I right? Yes, yeah.
That will always guide us to go in the right path, and that will save our time.
That is the target. It's like a target that we need to reach to.
Maybe hypothesis will give the solution for our, question.
Question.
Okay, you didn't answer one of my question. Is that sure that you should have hypothesis? A paper without hypothesis, is it not scientific?
For exploratory, I think hypothesis is not required, as you discussed.
For other studies?
And for other studies, we can have.
Okay, we can have. If you don't have.
You must have.
You must have.
See,
not required.
No. Rini is not, Rini is rephrasing my term. We can have, I'm asking, is it that we should have? And she's answered me, we must have. Not so at all, Rini. Either you can have research questions or you can have hypothesis. Equally, both are in. There are a lot of Springer published sources I have. They don't have hypothesis because they are not able to test something. They have research questions. They have found some answers for the question through their data and they have given some justification. But on present day, there are a lot of Scopus requirements goes with some scientific analysis of data. Then we are making hypothesis. But if you're going to make a qualitative research, there is a scope to make hypothesis. If you're going to make a case study technique under a qualitative research, okay, a lot of public relation, you are in media studies, filmmaking and all, a lot of case study method we are following, personal interview method we are following with respect to qualitative research analysis. That doesn't have any hypothesis at all. But they have been published in very high sources actually. So we should not have this mental struck about hypothesis. Hypothesis is nothing. Okay, hypothesis is just a tentative statement only. If it is, there is a possibility in your study to fit hypothesis, you can fit. If your study is more qualitative or exploratory, you need not have it. And it's not that only hypothesis that makes a study scientific. We need to come out of that. Okay. For example, I was working under a project of human resource development, MHRD. They had a project of crime against women. Okay. In Pondicherry only, those victims already who have been victims of different criminal activities. Okay. After a particular phase of time, people wanted to know their life, standard of living, because the guilt has been imprisoned. After that, sometimes they would have also come out of the things because of other political support and all. But ultimately, MHRD wanted to go back to these victims. Okay. Then find out their quality of life or the person is once again troubling them or police are making any issue with them and all to find out that we had a study and I was a field investigator in that study actually. And we need to go to every victim house and we need to write a case study. It was only case study method, the whole project we did. Every victim is a case for us and we will be narrating the whole case, pure qualitative, narrating the whole case and then we will nearly 10 to 15 cases per issue, that is rape, domestic violence, kidnapping, and then we had molestation and we had eve teasing like that. There are a lot of crime against women in every category, around 10, 15 cases. They've all been already registered issues only. That's why I referred them as dowry deaths and all, but we don't have victim for that. The victim is already no more. We are going to meet their family members like that. But all these we actually submitted and some of it we actually published also. It was also published in a very high source. Okay. But on the other side, that it doesn't have any hypothesis because it's a case study. Every case is a unique case. You cannot have a hypothesis at all. What are you going to say? It's about crime against women in India or crime against women in particular place, that is Pondicherry as a population, a particular geographical area. So, have in mind, in media studies also, there is all possibility you can go for qualitative research. Do no one, there is nothing like qualitative research is not equal on par with quantitative and all. Quantitative use a lot of numbers and it looks a lot of attractive things to you. But a lot of qualitative papers have been published in a lot of Sage and all. No, they look farmer suicide. Present day, farmers are sitting right now. Okay, that itself is a big study. Farmer suicide, a lot of studies of farmer suicide a decade before, this problem was very high. And once again, we have come back to that scenario today. Okay, it is just 10 years before you can go and check. There are a lot of farmer suicide cases in UP and all. It was on a very high wave at that time. And later on, little it came down. Now, comparatively better, we thought. But once again, different problem has boomed up. And right now, the strike is going on the other side. But so that cases, that's all case study. There is no hypothesis. What hypothesis will keep for that? Okay. So there are a lot of studies we can use without hypothesis also, with hypothesis, but depends on the study. Okay, it depends on the mode and the method of the study, design of the study that you're going to choose. But don't have fixation in your mind that only hypothesis that make the study, but hypothesis is good only if you're able to see. When you have a variable to be tested, you can have a hypothesis, but you don't have a variable to test, then you can't go and pull something and write as a hypothesis, then it becomes meaningless. Okay, so it's a proposed explanation of an observable phenomenon. See, obviously you say that you have a prediction about this is how this problem is going to end. So that is which Rini really read was a proper hypothesis. I said the statement like that, right? That is a hypothesis because you feel that it has a impact, but you have come out with an alternate hypothesis. Because when you say there is a relationship, it comes out with an alternate hypothesis. You say that there is. And then you say we are going to find out. Okay, I don't have any idea whether it has a relationship, but I'm going to find out. Then you're starting with a zero. That is null. As I yesterday itself I told, either you can start with a zero if you don't know anything. Blame. Better always to start with zero because we don't know. But there are a lot of studies on something. Okay, descriptive studies more we go with alternate because there are a lot of studies so you have in your mind and you check whether your alternate is right or not. And in any way, you're going to check only. Okay, so it is a kind of a specific statement of prediction that describes in concrete rather than in theoretical what you expect as far as your study is concerned. Okay, I know I'm running in short of time, so I'll move for it. You have to frame your hypothesis. I'm always available for you to check with that. We can frame little, I'll just go through and then we can make it in the end actually. And as this methods and tools we have discussed yesterday itself clearly, select your research design. Select your type of research, primary or secondary, qualitative or quantitative. Select your method. Method means what? Method of sampling, method of data collection, tool for data collection. So when we talk about tool for data collection, as I referred yesterday itself, it can be a survey-based questionnaire. It can be a survey based on interview schedule. Or it can be a case study, or it can be a focused group discussion, or it can be a personal interview. All these are methods used in media research I'm specifically referring to. And coming to gathering of data, okay. As I said, the data may be qualitative or quantitative, primary or secondary. When you just frame a questionnaire, okay, based on your objectives, you're going to frame a questionnaire. Okay, there is a pattern for a questionnaire. You need to go for a structured questionnaire. And maybe after this session, along with this PowerPoint, I will send you one particular document that will tell you what are the different aspects required in the questionnaire. A cover letter, an instruction, like that. There is a standard pattern that will help you to make a proper questionnaire, standard questionnaire, wherein if you circulate, people should know this questionnaire for what purpose. Many a time we just put the heading, start first question directly. No, that should not be. Because we can't expect what is any questionnaire hereafter, please have in your mind, if you're going to send it to people, attach the objectives and send the questionnaire. Or else it will not solve the purpose. Especially when you submit for the next forum and all, maybe those who are doing PhD and all, I'm telling, please remember, attach your objectives along with the questionnaire or else people will not know what you're trying to find out, man, like that. And make sure that you make a proper continuity in your questionnaire. Make sure there is no ambiguity. Never have this dozen questions at all. And never have two things, that is, do you drink or smoke? You're going to talk about drink or you're going to talk about smoke. And how often? That's a very bad question normally without asking people whether they have the habit. I've come across a number of questionnaires asking about how often you smoke. If I'm a non-smoker, what am I supposed to do, man? Okay, you put three options, often, regularly, and sometimes, and frequently, occasionally, and all. And I'm a non-smoker. What am I supposed to do? In any answer, you make me as a smoker. So that is a criteria of inclusion, exclusion, all to be taken in mind. See, preparing a questionnaire itself will go one complete session. Last week, I had a session to my students in the sense of, there was a VAP course, value added course program in VIT for a group of population, the same research methodology, only survey questionnaire. This for 2 days. How to conduct survey and especially sampling was involved in that, and how to prepare a questionnaire. One complete 2-hour session we had, open-ended, closed-ended question, wherein to use open-ended question, wherein to use closed-ended, Okay, some spaces where you need to give choice, we can give choice. In some spaces, you're going to ask them only, you don't know. So giving choice will restrict them, okay, to answer within that choice. So there are questions, you have to give it open-ended.
We must follow the measurement scales also.
Yeah, there are four variables we have: nominal variable, ordinal variable, interval variable, ratio variable. So yes, four variables to be followed when you prepare. That's why I said questionnaire alone takes one full session. And as I said, please identify the dependent and independent variable before you frame the questionnaire itself. It's very easy for analysis. Haphazard, you put all the questions from whatever comes to your mind. And later on, if you collect the data and you're going to analyze, it'll be very difficult to sort that out. So better have a set of dependent variable and independent variable. Pick it, write it separately, and reliability test. Way back and all, these things are not required. Anybody, whatever comes in their mind, write down some 25, 30 question, conduct any in any population. That is not possible on present day. Scientific day we are in. And there is all possibility we can ensure the reliability and validity of our data. So what we have to do is run the reliability test for your questionnaire. Even in SPSS, it is available. So run the reliability test. It will show you the decimal, and above 0.7 is considered to be reliable. Okay, 0.7 and above. If it is below 0.7, scientific papers, they don't agree. They would ask you what is the result of your reliability test, and you should be ready to give them. Especially if you're doing PhD, have these all in mind. In a forum, you're going to present for a synopsis or colloquium or something like that, you need to answer. So make sure that you run that and get it. So identify your dependent, independent variable. Okay, analysis. Analysis comes in where first you have to code. Okay, all the data we will collect. And all the data has to be coded. That is very important. While collecting itself, we actually will, these closed-ended questions have its own coding, but open-ended questions doesn't have any coding. So when you get the answers only, you're going to categorize those open-ended answers. Okay, so I remember when I was doing my undergraduation and all, it's a very big work. We do master chart, and we have a code book like that and all, but present day Excel or SPSS will, XPSS is really helpful in coding actually, because it has its own options there where you can add the subcategories, everything, and it itself filters the data like that. So SPSS filters it, but coding is very essential. You should have coding for all your questions. All your questions would be converted to the coding aspect, where you have a question of how many children you have, something like that, very basic question, maybe like A, B, C. So this A, B, C all to be coded. So when you enter, you need to enter as a code rather than enter as one children, two children, three children. So even those who have worked in SPSS will know that. So it you have the categories there. So what code you give, same code we have to enter as a data. It's very easy to work in once if you codify. Okay, and then identifying, as I said, you're going to find out the independent and dependent variable. And here in analysis, what you're going to do, don't directly jump into your hypothesis test. Of course, hypothesis test you're going to make and find out. But apart from that, okay, you have your hypothesis. You're going to test anything with respect to the requirement. It can be t-test or z-test, or it can be any test that you're going to put. It is going to tell whether it is significant or not, whatever it is. Beyond that, there are a lot of things you can do with your data. Okay, what we normally think is only hypothesis test, it is significant or not, accept or reject, work is over. No. Beyond that, you have a lot of data in your hand, man. A lot of other variables are there. Hypothesis is connecting few variables and you're getting an answer for your study. But beyond that, the study will get support from many other variables. So as I told, already you have taken, noted down the dependent and independent variable. Try to find out the relationship between them. Some correlation comes chi-square, things will be possible according to the choice of your sample. If it is probability, then you may have some other, some correlation regression is possible. Then if it is non-probability, chi-square is possible. Like that, try to bring in some kind of a relationship between different variables, wherein you will come out with some justification for your hypothesis. This does not have a significant relationship with this. Why? Because of those relationship will help you to tell that this has a significant effect on how the other relationship will explain you that. So have a clean understanding of your whole data and try to kind of find out relationship between these variables and then apply your required test hypothesis and find out their rejection or acceptance, so that these relationship between other variables will help to justify, because applying test is very easy. Software does that. But writing the inference is very difficult. Justifying and substantiating is very difficult. Either you use SPSS or off software, any software you put in, you get some points or fractions or decimals. But how to defend it, how to justify it, how to convert it, that is big. And when you analyze the other variables also, it will really help you to substantiate your hypothesis on the other side. Okay, so drawing inferences and writing. As I said, first make sure that find out your demographic data inferences. Don't think that it is useless. It is going to be of high use for any data, demographic data, where independent variables will really help. So first jot down all your inferences of demographic data and your variable data and the test inferences. And then if at all you apply some qualitative methods. Focus group discussion, you have a checklist, you conduct a focus group discussion, people would have expressed their opinions. Then if you would have had an interview, you had a case study, all inferences to be given separately. Okay, all these inferences to be given separately, separately, separately. It will really give the richness of your data, the quality, the extent of the quality that you have in the data. And I always suggest that go for a combination of quantitative and qualitative data collection. Don't go only merely quantitative. There is a very big disadvantage in this online scenario, that is, it's easy to send across questionnaires and get the information. And you have a mass information also, like 200, 400, 6,000, anything is possible. See, I have a population of 30,000 in Vellore campus and 20,000 in Chennai campus. If I want to make a study, I can make a 50,000 population just by sending some SMS to for some students or student council members, which would spread across people. But that is not going to solve the purpose. Everybody give their responses. But on the other side, if you're going to combine with the qualitative data, the reality, okay, the quality of information, the richness will really increase if you're going to get some real extracts from the people, okay, say from FGD or interview or case study or any method, get some real extracts and strengthen your data, okay? I'm not asking you to go for the whole 100 people with the interview, no. You can take the survey from 100 and have some 10 people for interview or 10 people for case study. That will strengthen your data and will help you a lot in writing your inferences. Okay, you will understand the whole scenario from the 10 people, not from the 100 that you get from your real survey data actually. And add all these things in your inferences. Very important, state your limitation. Nobody can do a complete research, okay? All of us have some limitations when we go with our research. Please be very honest in stating your limitation. There is nothing wrong, okay? It only expresses your assertiveness as a researcher and social relevance of the study. To what extent this particular study will help the society or will answer a social problem, or to what extent it is going to come out with a social outcome. And then please you yourself, if not you, who else then? Like that, you yourself try to write a scope for further research. I have done all these things, but these things you're not able to do. That you please lead a write as a scope. These all points will express you as a real researcher, a best researcher like that. So you just write a paper adding all these subheadings, because it will become a complete researcher. Work, what you have done, it can be a piece of work, but you should be complete in that, like that. So scope for further research, and then you can put your own conclusion stating that this is what I have understood, this is what I have analyzed, and this is what I have found in my study, like that. It is your conclusion. And as I told in the abstract, same I'm telling in the conclusion, please don't take conclusion from others. It's very easy to go and see a big paragraph people have written as conclusion, because very general lines are there and pasting it in yours. Conclusion is yours. There is no need for any introduction what you wrote from secondary data for conclusion. Conclusion is ultimately yours. What is your travel is all about? What is that you have landed in? Write that as a conclusion. The reader will really be happy when they read it because it becomes more from the researcher point of view. Okay, so write your own conclusion. Think that you are writing your own book like that. Then you will obviously draw your conclusions. Yes, I know it's now 4:26. Let's have fun with the steaming coffee or with tea, that whichever is possible. As yesterday, I tried to put it across my email ID and contact number. I know I have not completed this responsibility given to me. It was very much a vast area, ocean, as I said. Let us all try to swim. I've only given some small wooden planks to you. Okay, you can hold it and swim in this ocean like that. To my extent, I've given some wooden planks. And whenever you require a plank, lack of plank, call me. I'll give another plank. You can just hold it and you can swim. Okay. Let me stop sharing. Yes.
If you have any questions, you can discuss here, dear team.
Yes, it can be question, feedback, anything, open doubts, anything.
That was a really interactive and a very clear session. And I really like the Excel idea which you gave for writing down the literature review. I think that will definitely help. I mean, that is one kind of a suggestion which I think I have not come across so far. So I'll try doing that. I have one more question, not a question, a suggestion.
Yes, sir.
Because sometimes what happens is in especially our disciplines, it is very difficult to find literature review. So we can only write elaborate literature and then just mention that, you know, this particular paper or this particular thesis or this particular research is missing the aspect which I am trying to look at. So that way I can elaborately go with around 20, 30 or 40. So ideally, what should be the number of literature review which should go into the PhD thesis or something like that?
Sir, PhD thesis, ideally number, if you ask me, there are differences with respect to universities. Central government, state government, university expectation, I will tell you. Private university expectation, I'll tell you. But it may differ from institute to institute. Okay. And as far as we can take a screenshot for report purpose.
No.
Okay, you are.
Yes, Renan, sir, is taking.
The communication is towards the organizers, sir, between you. Okay. I'm sorry. Dhananjay, sir, to answer you. Yeah. For PhD thesis, if I say, you will be a little surprising. But on the other side, that is the requirement. Around some. You need to cross the century, actually. Will it be possible, Dhananjay, sir?
Madam, it's possible. I mean, you can even do 10,000 also.
Related to research topic. I'm putting a hole there. You know, private universities' expectation is around 80 to 120, something like that. But on the other side, state government, central government universities are 50 to 70 articles if you're going to... This is what which I have come across, I'm telling, because I've been some PhD external examiners for few colleges, universities. With that, I'm telling you, because I have done one PhD only. So not because of that, I'm telling in that way. But I have been as a external examiner, say for Selemari's or different colleges. I've been as an external examiner. I've been for the Viva to declare the PhDs. With that, I'm telling you, state, central, to some extent, okay. But when it comes to private, the expectation is very high because they wanted to actually bring up better benchmarking, because always private institutes, we know, we try to make our benchmark in a better level. That is the reason the expectation is high. But as you said, in your area of research, there is with respect to review of literature, I want to tell one more thing. See, review of literature, don't go for a paragraph on the sense standard review of literature for around 100 or 80 reviews of articles. Rather than, please subcategorize it. Okay, you have your objectives. And you have your, even I would say that according to the objectives, the thesis also can be categorized. This is with respect to thesis alone I'm talking about, not for papers. Those who wanted to pursue a PhD and pursuing a PhD, one, your chapters, first of all, you can actually subcategorize. For example, you have three objectives, major objective, other than demographic, other than the last one, in between three major. The three major objectives can be the chapter headings. Apart from chapter 3 methodology, chapter 4, chapter 5, like that, it can be, or 4.1, 4.2, 4.3, because some universities, they have only 5 chapters. 4 means it is only analysis, like that. But it can be 4.1, 4.2, 4.3, that's why I'm referring to. Try to subcategorize according to your objective, more welcoming you will get in your thesis, actually, and every category you can publish separately. That is why I'm specifying this. Okay. Every category, in sense, every objective itself, you can try for one publication. But as I said, you should not end up in any plagiarism in the end, because it's already been published like that. You need to be smart enough. What you're going to publish, as I said, you can publish a review paper before you go for a submission. But review paper and review of literature, that your chapter 2 should be different. The review paper is the gist of it. So it should not create any plagiarism, but self-plagiarism is acceptable to some extent. So there you will have a percentage differences also. But on the other side, when it comes to review of literature, which we are talking about, try to subcategorize the review of literature. That is in the world level, in international level, then Indian level, or with respect to that particular topic level. Like that, you can bring in, narrow down, because as you said, in your area, there will be very less papers, but you have to find out a broad area, because you have already, you had a broad area, only then you have narrowed down your topic. But you start your review with a broad area. That is why I said literature review. Add your literature review in the review of literature. Then the strength of review will increase. Okay, total education system for Arun sir, I'm talking about. Gokul sir. Total education system itself can be the beginning of his review of literature. Okay, Gurukula system also, there can be 3 papers, 5 papers you can review. How was the system of education? What all the transformation happened in education? Okay, how was it before COVID? Because of COVID? Okay, what is on presenting? If I'm going to take it, I may have more than 500 articles in front of me, which is accessible to me. Very important. Reviewers should be, the article should be accessible to me. Yeah. Okay. So in this way, you can increase the strength of your review. And this is also on the other side. This is the process will tell that people, that the one, the reader, that is the PhD evaluator, you have had a broad idea and you have narrowed down it. So you have a background understanding of this particular zone. So these are all the way the evaluators will look at. We may think that evaluators will not see the review of literature at all. Like that. Not so. Not so. You can actually look in a lot of foreign examiners, their comments. Okay, very important. If somebody is presenting their PhD viva, you need to wait for the last moment after their viva presentation is over. The Indian examiner will come and explain the questions about the comments about the foreign examiner and Indian examiner. Hmm. Most of the foreign examiners, actually, they talk about review of literature. We always have a feeling that nobody will look our reviews like that. Not so. They see the strength of the review. With that, they evaluate your understanding with respect to the topic.
Yes.
Okay. So,
madam, I agree with that.
Yeah. So we need to project in such a way that strength of review is good, means we can start with a wider perspective, then narrow down. So there is a lot more possibility to bring in more articles in that. If there are very few in your area also, it will not be explicitly shown, but review should end. See, starting paragraph and ending paragraph you should have for review. An introduction for review is required. That is, you're going to explain. Okay, don't directly start with one particular author's name. A review should have a preamble and review should have an end. The end is nothing but the research gap that you identify from the review of literature. That is where the loop gets corrected.
Some of the US university thesis I read, they are very beautiful in the beginning, but terrible in the end. So the literature review is actually the big difference there. They write the literature very beautifully. I mean, you are almost into the zone. By the time the outcome comes, you completely forget about what exactly the outcome is about. So coming to the research papers, again, it's a very big challenge. I think hardly we'll mention 5 or 10 literature reviews, and not more than that in terms of research paper.
Yeah, research paper, that is enough. But when it comes to a PhD thesis, that is not enough, no. So there's on the other side, how to strengthen it, how to increase it. Then we can't go for some other area and write it. But our own area, we can make a broader perspective, start from that, and then come down, and especially give subsections. Please, it should not be monotonous pages of reviews of literatures, literature of some number of pages. Then it is very difficult. Rather than we need to actually subcategorize, even for us, it is very, will be more understandable if we do that.
Yes, yes.
Thank you. I think, ma'am,
in the Excel file, you can put the category also, then add one column.
There is one more suggestion, ma'am, in the chat box regarding self-plagiarism.
Yes, yes, sir.
Yeah.
Is not acceptable now. Max 10% plagiarism. Yes, 10%. That's what I said. The percentage according to the institute. Okay. Self-plagiarism to some extent, that's what I said, is allowed. With 10%, they accept. After that, they are not accepting. But even that will not show in self-plagiarism.
Which is, sorry for interruption. Which will be treated as self-plagiarism?
Self-plagiarism is your own name, you've already published it. The same data outcome, you've already published in your own name. In the course of PhD, we are expected to publish, actually. But on the other side, when we publish, there is a limitation that the same data, when you're going to, the same outcome, you're going to put it in our research and we're going to test in Turnitin, it will show self-plagiarism. So that limitation is there. So we need to actually be smart enough. That's why I said your research paper, a review paper, you make your chapter two. But chapter two is something different, the whole review of literature. But in a review paper, what you're going to make is the gist of it. And when you write the review paper, you need to be smart enough to rephrase the lines, which will not affect your chapter two. It's very easy when you make a paper, rephrasing it. But later on, if you're going to sit and rephrase your thesis, it is going to be difficult. When it shows plagiarism, what we do, we get the plagiarism report and we sit with our own thesis. What we do, we try to convert, change the phrases, words. Okay, your own thesis only. You're not going to take from somebody. Your own lines sometimes, it will show plagiarism. It may be your own lines, but it is being used often by many because we all are using the same language. So the language, which has a very big problem here, the statements are used by many people. I'm talking about some standard statements. And that we are going to use in your research, if you're going to use, you're not going to copy from somebody, but it will show in plagiarism because it's a familiar statement. What we do, we sit and keep this side our report and that side our own document and try to rephrase. End of the day, the whole meaning of the sentence will change. Okay, what we try to say, that gets affected. So for that, I would always suggest, don't try to rephrase, read that and write it once again. That is only possible. Don't change that term and try for synonym. Those things will not work out at all when it comes in a mass volume. Okay, only few things, it's okay. If it is 32, you're putting, trying to make it 30, then it's all difficult, okay. But on the other side, better while writing itself, choose some good words, go for, that's why review of literature will help us. As I said, the strength and weakness, we are going to convert and write on your own, write on your own. You are actually molding yourself to write your thesis. Okay, you are actually molding yourself to write your paper or thesis, whatever it is, while you are going to comment on somebody's article as a review, quoting its strength and weakness. Obviously, it comes out from you then, and it enters your mind, and that makes you as a phrase. Do we have anything? Your self-plagiarism is not acceptable, 10%. Average 100 for PhD thesis for good results finding and comparative study paraphrasing. I'm not getting actually, sir. Average 100 for PhD thesis means...
No, actually there was a question earlier, ma'am. How many paper we should be go for the...
And I also told that a century you have to cross like that.
Because all good university, we are expecting specifically if we are dealing with a scientific core science paper chemistry, physics and mathematics, 50 is too much enough. For that, for mass communication and journalism and media art and design, commonly 100 is acceptable.
Sociology, sir, because there is big volume of sources available.
Right.
That is one another reason. Yes.
Right, ma'am. So comparative study would be much better, and this is end of the day. Thesis motto is only one. Commonly, it should be over there. We are giving some tribute to society, but in our country, what happening? thesis or PhD means getting one doctor degree and getting the job. This is the problem here.
Yes. On present day, PhD is considered to be an entry gate, entry passport, like that. But on the other side, if we are really, and one more thing, we need to remember that for those who are doing PhD, I'm telling, you have a lot of scope to make research after PhD. So don't land into a very big zone for PhD. Of course, you need to pursue it and all, it's fine. But on the other side, as server specifying also, there is a big expectation with respect to the requirement that you should have a PhD if you want to enter into the next level and all. So please make sure that a researchable, feasible problem you choose, finish it, get your degree. Then you have a very big scope to jump into any area, find anything new, explore anything like that and all. But on the other side, don't try to explore all those things in your research phase. Then you are putting yourself into a struggle only. It's a humble suggestion or an advice you can take in any way. But these two words, researchable and feasibility. Have that in mind. Take something that is possible, feasible at whichever point of the place you are there. Try to make that completed. Then aspirations are already there. You are always there. And you can do. And you have more freedom to do. Because PhD, there is a restriction. You're working on a particular guide with respect to the expectation of the guide you're working, with respect to the guidance you have to go with. So there is a limitation. So after pursuing that, you don't have any limitation. You don't have anything, no restriction. Then you have all the freedom to write. Similarly, in the phase of PhD also, sometimes we will be traveling on one and suddenly we will get something new. Wow, this point. Don't immediately change your track. That point you just take and keep it. Sometimes if you're really interested, write one paper on it separately. That will solve your mind. That is to satisfy your mind, to quench like that. But don't change the track. Because there are a lot of new things will come up. If you keep on changing, then you will not complete it at all. So you have already made a track, go on it and finish it. That's all. Don't feel that, no, I should have done something else. I should have been that contemption, like in life, how much it is required. In research also, it is required. Okay, 100% you should have that contemption. Yes, Gokul sir, you wanted to say something.
Yes, ma'am, actually, see what happened is from next year onwards, a few of our faculties, we are going to do PhD, but still we are confused about which topic or which one we have to select for our PhD in fine arts or animation or a graphic area. So any suggestion or idea about?
Very good, sir. You should be confused only. Okay. Confusion is always good. Confusion is a very good start. Now, when normally I always go with the self-disclosures only. When I started my research, I registered my PhD with a proposal for labor welfare. Okay. Because my MA project was on labor welfare. So that whichever area I'm comfortable to defend on the interview board, I chose that. And then I got selected and I registered. My guide said, what have you decided? Same on labor welfare. I said, I don't know. Since I have been, I know this area, I just entered. He said, no, you take 6 months. Okay. This was my guide's explanation. You take 6 months and you just try on different topics and then you land on a topic, whichever is comfortable to you. And what I did in 6 months is there are some 6-7 areas you would be interested on. I tried my level best to make some small primary studies in all these areas. And I went for a lot of presentations. Okay, a lot of conference presentations wherein I saw a lot of presentations on same topic by others. Mine would be very small, 20, 30 people. It's okay. But I was a very budding scholar at that time. But when I listened to a lot more people's presentation, earlier I was interested in gerontology. Gerontology means about elderly. I made some small studies, loneliness among elderly, old age home. I went for small survey and all with different population. I went for different conferences like that. Like that, I pitched into different areas. Those different areas are my specific interested areas.
Okay.
It may be for others different. As you said, there are some 4-5 areas we are having confusion which to land on. You try all 4-5 areas, try to have some papers in 4-5 areas. What is wrong? There is nothing wrong. Okay. And in the course of my own journey, once I participated in a conference of microfinance in my own campus only, when I saw all these women empowering because of the new concept. At that time, it was new concept, Mohammed Yunus, brainchild, this self-help group and microfinance concept. And I was like, all these marginalized women, I'm talking about women who are not able to be accessible for anything. They were coming into the mainstream because of this self-help group. That took my interest. being a woman, maybe, I don't know. But on the other side, that was because that has become my final area of research. And then I went to my guide and I told that this I have decided. Then I started my literature review on it. And that's how my journey came. But yes, before you register also, you can do this. Sometimes you may not have the flexibility with your guide as I had with my guide. I had my 1 year travel with respect to finding of topic itself, because I didn't have my MPhil. I was a direct PhD student after my PG. So 1 year I had my coursework, all those things to be completed. So those, that 1 year phase I used for exploring all the areas. Similarly, I was preparing for my NET examination, JRF, all those I had time to clear. So that 1 year for my research, he didn't question me anything. After 1 year only, I told him that this is what I have decided to do. But that at that time, I had 10 papers presented in 10 different conferences. It's not, I'm not telling, boosting about myself, but this way, okay, you can try. And I got this flexibility because of my guide. I owe my all my gratitude to him. But to you, before registering itself, you have the flexibility now as a teacher. You have a set of students in your hand. You have all the areas which you can explore. Explore small, small papers as you are trying to do it now. Similarly, do in all the areas one paper. You will know the nuances in that area and pros and cons, possibility aspect, okay, which has a greater scope, where you can actually come out with the social relevance, all those things. Or you can invent some new app, as our Arun sir was telling. Okay, some thing exploring new that he can, a piece of information that he can bring, come out like that, then you will come for this confusion will actually, so will be solved. Then you will have a concrete understanding that this is my area. But once you have decided your area, as I already said, please don't change the track, because it is only a small journey for 2 to 3 years completed. The whole life you have to explore. Okay. But we always do a mistake that I should have not taken this. I should have taken that. Never we actually get satisfied at all. If somebody else presents something, we always feel really interesting. Such an interesting. This is what mine. I should have not taken this like that. Please don't feel that in every area there is a uniqueness. As you always say, every discipline has uniqueness. It can be arts or science or anything that has some uniqueness in it like that. Similarly, every topic, in that topic, what uniqueness you can bring in. Like that, you try to find out and try to finish it. If you're not able to bring in much uniqueness also, it's not a problem. But that journey is a very short-term journey that you have to register in your mind. So make an assertive attempt. Only that is required in that journey is an honest and assertive attempt. That will actually take you to a proper end level. That is, you can pursue a PhD. So that is more important. Otherwise, everything is there always for us in with us.
Sure, ma'am. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, anything else? Hope I have
a conclusion, ma'am. I totally agree with your word. Before starting the PhD or the PhD topic, there is a very important thing: identify a good PhD guide.
That's a blessing. That's a blessing,
sir. Sometimes that is not in our hands, sir.
Yeah. That's actually a blessing.
If you get the, right guide, that is, fortunate.
No, I am blessed. No, to have yes,
ma'am. Totally agree.
Sir, all of us are blessed, sir. So many of us,
we feel that at the end of the, PhD only. By the time of submission only.
I would actually relate this with one aspect of our life.
Say during the journey of PhD, we feel that, this is horrible.
See, I will relate this with one aspect of our life partner. Okay. We always somehow, whether we like it or not, we somehow manage and live with our life partner. So once you're fixed with your research guide, make up your mind. Okay. With respect to the expectations, with respect to your own expectations, matching both neutrally, you will finish it. Sometimes we also compromise this with respect to our life partner.
We must understand in each other.
Yeah. Both the ends are there. And one more thing is, with respect to us, it is you who are going to pursue the research. There is nothing wrong if you're going to compromise on few things.
Yes, ma'am.
In life, with a life partner, we are compromising. Sometimes we don't like their father or mother, but still when they come home, yes, come on, please come in. We do that. We serve them. But why? As far as research is concerned, what we think?
It teaches us patience here.
That is a very great journey of life, sir. And I would say that we are all really blessed because we all did full-time PhD. That 3 years of full-time PhD molded our personality itself. Not only like academically, knowledge-wise, behavior-wise, in all the aspects, it molded our personality. I always owe this to my guide because in every aspect, in teaching, in department, interpersonal relationship, he gives a lot of nuances, advices to us. In this particular moment, don't speak. Let them. Or other moment, you are supposed to speak. Like that, his own behavioral expression, we normally read and we are socialized and we are molded with respect to it. And that is why we are able to survive in this academic field for this many years with respect to it. It can be a private university I'm with, but I'm traveling. My first job was with VIT only. Soon after my PhD, I just submitted my synopsis, not even my thesis. I directly joined in VIT. I was 25 at that time. I joined as an assistant professor. It was a great blessing. It was a cut through or a very streamlined career for me. I didn't have any break. PG, UG, PG, PhD, and direct job like that. But it was a blessing, I'll say. And everybody is blessed in one or other way. That is sure. On the other side, how much we are actually utilizing the opportunity. And life is full of compromises. That will really help us in everywhere with respect to every individual. And on the other side, yes, interpersonal relationship building. Okay, it is not about, we have to respect all the individual. Every individual has their own dignity in their life. Please give respect to all individual. Even when you're going to collect data, every respondent to be given much importance. And that will really help us to complete our, and that wish of them itself will really help us to complete our PhD in a stipulated time. I know I have gone beyond the topic today, but thanks for reminding me my research life experience and all. And all the best for all of you with a great success in your life with respect to your research as well as with respect to your life.
Thank you, ma'am. It's a very wonderful session, very informative, knowledgeable. Thanks a lot, ma'am. I just called her ma'am, we had 15 days FTP, could you please allow 2 days for us, spend for us? Immediately, ma'am, she told me, yes, Bhavna, go ahead. Thanks a lot, ma'am. Thank you so much.
It is a great opportunity for me to meet all the faculty members of JAIN, especially with respect to animation, gaming, and what was one more?
Digital filmmaking.
Filmmaking.
Finally, you forget me, ma'am, these 2 days.
Your students department only.
Yeah, my student department is always there. But the other department people are new to me and their relationship as I have got through this particular forum. Hope I have meet up to your expectation to a little extent. And
very much, sir. Very much, ma'am.
And always I'm open for further queries. Anytime you can call me or mail me. And I wish to extend a good relationship with all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Ananda. Thank you.
Thank you all.